There is over 600 million malicious programs in existence today, and each day additional 390,000 malwares are being created. How do you possibly protect yourself from malware when it's present in such huge volumes? You can become a victim of cyber attacks without even being a primary target of the actors. It's like being caught in the middle of crossfire during armed conflict. Since 2005, there have been at least 7,756 breaches, and that's just the ones that were made public so far. If you have owned a Yahoo account, your login credentials have been on sales on the darknet since 2013, as details of about 1 billion Yahoo users have been stolen by unknown hackers. If you had a Google account in around 2010, you might have been trapped in the cyber espionage campaign that was orchestrated against the search giant and 34 other US tech companies in order to gain sensitive intelligence. Companies are often reluctant to disclose their failure to protect their data because of fears of public outrage and fallout of the prices of the shares. You, as an average user, are just like an innocent civilian in the middle of a conflict zone left to the will of those who are fighting. With such huge frequency of successful breaches, clandestine nature of cyber warfare, and the eternal uncertainty of your cybersecurity, the most rational outcome is to always assume that you are a target for someone and that your security have been compromised. Even if you can satisfactorily prove your integrity now, in the current cyber state, the best cybersecurity defense strategy is to assume a breach will eventually happen. No matter how you prepare, if a skilled enough hacker wants to get to you, they will get to you. The best you can do is to make sure they can't do anything once they manage to breach through your defenses. This is cyber warfare. It's another addition to our capability to potentially destroy the world alongside other weapons of mass destruction such as biological weapons, chemical weapons, and nuclear bombs. But unlike with other types of destructive technology, cyber weaponry doesn't have a non-proliferation treaty or containment agreement. Just like with nuclear bombs at the beginning of the Cold War, everybody is stockpiling their cyber weapons and nobody is bound by international restrictions on their usage. But what's more troubling about cyber warfare that's not an issue with, say, nuclear weapons, is that anybody can really develop destructive capabilities, not just governments in advanced economies, but even small non-state groups acting for their own interests. Only a handful of states rich enough to afford nuclear technology have also developed nukes, but anybody can become a hacker with potential to take down the whole grid overnight. Successful hackers can be as young as teenagers. Currently, the cost of cybercrime exceeds $400 billion every year. That number is going to soar to $2 trillion in 2019 and will hit $6 trillion mark by 2021. This is of course excluding the potential ramifications of large-scale attacks on critical infrastructure. Cybercrime is the biggest threat businesses face today, with around 20% of small to medium-sized enterprises that have become targets of cybercriminals. This is to illustrate how futile it is to rely on a single product to protect your digital assets. Cybersecurity is not a product, it's a process. There are no 10 tips to protect yourself from malware. You have to redesign your mindset to be always prepared to defend your valuable part on the cyberspace. If there is a commercial antivirus program that advertises to you protection against 99.9% of threats, even if that were true, you are still unprotected from 7 million malwares. There are so many vectors of infection that it's impossible for skilled cybersecurity experts to cover them all, not to mention average users. Fortunately, there are key basic principles around which most malware types are programmed and which you can follow to keep yourself protected against cyber threats. You just need to understand these principles and implement changes to your protections against malware accordingly. In order for any program to be installed, it requires administrative privileges. Unix-like operating system architecture offers this option to you by default. Most popular operating systems based on Unix are Linux and macOS. Windows doesn't provide this separation, which is a problem. It is strongly advised that you limit your usage of your device on root access as much as possible. Use non-admin accounts whenever you don't need to install new software. On Linux, installed programs do not get administrative privileges unless you specifically approve it by entering your password. So even if a malware infiltrates your computer, you would have to grant it root access in order for it to do any damage. No system is perfectly secure, so even Linux has its vulnerabilities, but its amount is minuscule compared to the ones of Windows. There are countless of ways how you can install Linux alongside your Windows or macOS without losing any data. You can easily search tutorials on how to do this on YouTube. The best approach for maximum security is to use Linux for day-to-day browsing, communication, email, banking, etc., and use other operating systems only when you really have to use a software that doesn't run on Linux. Bear in mind that your device is almost always connected to a network. Even if your system is protected, You might be connected to a vulnerable device that can allow malware to spread to you. Beware of the network security you are connected to. Never do things on a public Wi-Fi that you would do at home. Don't send any passwords through an untrusted network. Never trust anyone with your data. If you think of cyberspace as a battlefield, take encryption as your armor and shield. Always use encryption and encrypt everything you can. Without it, you are going naked against fully armed soldiers. For this, I would suggest that you install HTTPS everywhere and uBlock Origin add-ons on your web browser. Whenever you are logging into your account, always check the website's encryption and certificate. If it doesn't match, don't proceed with entering your login credentials. Assume that someone will get a remote access to your device. Encrypt your hard drives so that even if you were hacked, the attackers won't be able to read your data without privileges. You can even encrypt sensitive files with separate passwords with programs like VeraCrypt. To protect your data from getting remotely encrypted by ransomwares, backup everything regularly on an offline location. Remember that 2 is 1 and 1 is none. Change your thinking from passwords to passphrases. Make them long but memorable. I'm talking about at least 25 characters long. A passphrase like "Jake Paul is 200% savage and white boy" is a 31 character long passphrase that's much harder to break than something random with upper and lower case, numbers and symbols, and can't come from a dictionary, which you will have hard time to remember. For messaging, emails and voice and video calls, only use those services that offer end-to-end encryption. Never trust Facebook, Google, Apple or Microsoft with the integrity of your data. They are primary targets of every major cyber attack, and their business model is to build backdoors for every government request and sell your data to whomever is willing to pay. Services like ProtonMail, Tutanoda, Signal or Jitsi are viable options that give you significant security and privacy. Consider transferring to those as soon as possible and secure them with unique passwords. For more information about these services, check out my online privacy tutorial where I explain more in detail about how you can secure your data. Compartmentalize your security. Never use the same password twice. If a hacker gets password to one of your accounts, the first that will come to their mind is to try them on other platforms. Two-factor verification has a great value, but if you have to use an SMS, at least use a SIM card that doesn't have your real name on it. Check your security updates of your software on a daily basis, but never think that's enough. Remember how the NSA tells companies not to fix certain vulnerabilities for them to exploit and weaponize. And we know this because the almighty NSA itself was hacked. If even the organization with the biggest cybersecurity budget in the world is susceptible to hackers with enough patience and skills, everybody is basically defenseless in the cyberspace. Don't rely solely on your antivirus software to do the job for you. It's advisable to have it installed, but it won't replace your habits designed around probability of successful breaches. For example, because Linux has such a secure architecture, most distributions are well off with just a good firewall configuration and don't need to bother with installing an antivirus. Encryption, separation of root and user access, regular updates and backups, and constantly aware mindset will get you further than you think. No other operating system that you can get is doing a better job at security than Linux. Remember, security is all about adding layers that will increase the time it takes to break in and thus decrease the motivation of the attackers. If somebody can brute force your passwords because they are so complicated and can't get root access to your device or read your encrypted files, they might be quickly turned off and move on to the next target, or it will simply increase the cost of their hacking to the point it might stop being beneficial for them. This tutorial is not excessive, but it will get you started. There are so many new threats being developed and each one will require attention, so I hope this will get you on the right track on how to protect yourself from malware. If you enjoyed my work, be sure to give it a like, share and leave a comment with your thoughts. Thanks for watching, and I invite you to subscribe for more content about cyberspace in the future.